Hi, and welcome to the Insider English Language Edition. I'm Michael Weiss, one of the editors of the publication, and I'm joined today by Christo Grozev and Roman Dobrokhotov, the editor-in-chief. And we're here to discuss the assassination of Yevgeny Prigozhin, the infamous command or financier and oligarch behind the Wagner Corps, who was blown up just a few hundred miles northwest of Moscow on Wednesday in what U.S. intelligence has said is almost certainly an assassination ordered by Vladimir Putin, the Russian president. This has been all over the international press for understandable reasons, given Wagner's role in not only the war in Ukraine, but also the Russian intervention in Syria and interventions in a host of other countries around the world, specifically in Africa. And I can't think of two better guests to have on the program than Christo and Roman, both of whom have broken innumerable stories about Prigozhin as a person, but also Wagner as this not really even paramilitary or private military company, but it's essentially what we now know to be an extension of the Russian state and the Ministry of Defense. Roman, Christo, welcome. Let's start with the most obvious and basic question. I mean, what do we know right now about how Prigozhin was taken out? Initial reports suggested this might have been a surface-to-air missile, Russian air defense systems that blew up his private jet as it was returning to Russia. But now there seems to be some contradictory reporting coming out in the United States from intelligence sources who suggest that this may have been a bomb placed aboard the aircraft or some kind of act of sabotage. What are you guys learning? What have you... your source is telling you?
Well, first, let me start first. I don't think we have credible information on what exactly happened technically and how exactly the plane went down. There are conflicting reports, some of them leaked through the FSB connected or linked Telegram channels, suggesting that, oh, for sure it was a missile because there were witnesses who heard and saw two explosions at the time that the plane started going down in a spiral. This would be consistent with at least one of the types of surface-to-air missiles that Russia uses in a pair, usually. Mm-hmm. Other experts, again, from Russia started opining on it by saying, oh, it definitely was an air-to-air missile, mm-hmm. because we see the shrapnel on one of the wings that fell down that is consistent with an air-to-air missile, and that would be more consistent with the lack of the kind of the smoke trail that you would see from a surface-to-air. Then again, the initial indications or initial leaks from the official investigation, whatever that is, and it's in quotation marks investigation here, is that it was a bomb, or most likely was a bomb. Now, Roman, I would ask you for an opinion on this, because we don't know, but we will know in the next few days, that's for sure. But it would make more sense for it to be a bomb, because if Putin were to try to blame the Ukrainians or the Kadyrovites, and we'll get to that in the conversation, I'm sure, then a bomb is much more versatile. It's much more universal. Anybody can put a bomb in a present for Prigozhin or in the luggage compartment, but very few people can shoot a missile, and those would be directly in the line of command of Putin. So that's why I think the most likely method was a bomb.
Right, but that is the interesting question, because if we learn that this is a missile, that means that Putin deliberately decided to make it that way, that everybody understands that it was him and that he's not afraid to show that. So this would be a signal to everybody inside and outside Russia that he doesn't give a damn about this. So he can kill whatever in the plane above Tver, which is close to Moscow, right in the middle of Russia. So it's also, we actually had the same question with Novichok. So why would he use Novichok if he can use any other poison that is much more easily accessible for everybody? But maybe that also was a part of the message that, like, everybody knows that it is here. But this is just a conspiracy because, yeah, Novichok has very many other reasons to use. I agree with you that it is, for now, it is more likely that it is a bomb, because it will be more logical to then to blame, for example, Ukrainians. Let's
interrupt you here, because you make a good point. What is the message? What is the required message for this assassination? The message it would not fulfill the goal for Putin if this was not a clear affiliation with him. But that clarity is not needed for the general electorate. It's not needed for the plebeian electorate of Russia. It's only needed for the elites. The elites get the message. Everybody among the elites, the power elites and the political elites, know that Putin did it, directly or indirectly. So it doesn't matter, actually, for them. But, for, I mean, the phrasing, the messaging from him, doing the godfather kind of eulogy, saying, oh, he was a nice but complicated man.
Made mistakes.
And made mistakes. That was so typically out of Vito Corleone's script. He doesn't need more than that. But for the electorate, for the babushkas in the countryside, for them to believe, oh, it couldn't be our guy, because for them, he doesn't need that message. He just needs the message, oh, we're under attack. And for them, it will be Ukraine did it, or but somebody who hated him did it.
Everything about what has happened in this summer, right? I mean, in what, late June, around midsummer, we had this abortive, some people call it a mutiny. I think we've chosen to describe it as an attempted coup.
Well, certainly Putin thought so.
Putin thought it was a coup. He described them as traitors. He looked really angry and hostile, although everything about this since has not really made much sense, right? I mean, in the annals of Russian history, somebody who tries to overthrow the regime and decapitate the Tsar, we know what happens to that person immediately, right? And yet there was this weird parlay with Putin in Moscow. Prigozhin was coming in and out of the country like it was his living room, right? Even though he was meant to be in exile in Belarus. We saw this, I don't know if this was just theatrical or it was legitimate at the time, that the erection of this tent community for Wagner fighters in Belarus who declined to sign contracts with MOD. Why wait this long to kill him? And then why kill him? You know, there are other ways. What I'm on, you were saying, using Novichok. There are other calling cards of Kremlin assassination attempts. Why do something so spectacular as to destroy a plane? I mean, right in the heart of Russia. They could have taken him out in Africa, where he was just not even a week ago, right? Why choose this method?
Well, I can suggest a dozen of beautiful theories of why he did this way, not another. But there is, I think, I would choose a simplest explanation why it happened this way. First of all, why this time, not earlier? Well, first of all, because at first days, a dozen of thousands of Wagner troops were in Russia, still ready to go to Moscow. So he was waiting for them to give up all the arms and relocate to Belarus. So he eliminated the danger for himself. And while doing so, Putin tried to persuade Prigozhin that they are not enemies anymore. That means that he needed to show that, well, there are some other tasks in Africa, in other places, and you can meet with African leaders in St. Petersburg during the conference. And it was almost official. So Prigozhin published photos with these leaders in a hotel near the near the conference. So it looks like Prigozhin believed that there is a deal, which is very stupid for Prigozhin because he knew Putin for at least 20 or even maybe 30 years, because Putin in his speech mentions that he knows Prigozhin from early 1990s, which we didn't know personally. But okay, maybe it's true. So anyway, it's from point of view of game of game theory, it is an interesting situation when you have two psychopaths that knows that they can't trust each other, but they still have to make a deal because they don't want to lose everything in the battle against each other. So it was very interesting what kind of a deal was that when he stopped near Moscow during his march to Kremlin. So what was the part of the deal? So I think my personal opinion is that at that moment, was it 23rd of June or 24th, I don't remember. So at that moment, when Putin was negotiating, he already knew he's going to kill Prigozhin in next 2 months. So he just needed anything to make Prigozhin believe that, well, we can decide this on that way. So what I don't understand is how Prigozhin was so stupid to believe that, in India it's called holding tiger by a tail. If you get a tiger by a tail, you just can't leave it because you die, right? So how Prigozhin was so stupid to believe in this new deal.
Let me ask you, Christo, because the three of us have talked about this at length. To what extent are there Prigozhin loyalists scattered throughout all echelons of the Russian military industrial complex, the defense establishment, the security architecture? We published a story a few weeks ago querying sources in the FSB, GRU, Border Guard, I think Interior Ministry, all of whom basically said there were two prevailing sentiments on the day of the coup. One was of maximum indifference, like, we don't give a shit. Let him take the country. It doesn't change anything for us. Or not so sneaking or quiet sympathy, cheering on Prigozhin to go ahead because there needs to be this house cleaning. Obviously, it seems, maybe not so obviously, Putin has caught wind of the fact that there is a fifth column in his regime. We have now fairly credible reporting that Surovikin has not only been removed as head of the aerospace forces, but is under house arrest. He was somebody seen as being a little too close to Prigozhin. Wasn't he an honorary Wagner member? More reporting, no doubt, will come out about covert or even overt sympathizers of Wagner within the government and the military. Why it seems to me that Prigozhin had a real ample room for maneuver and opportunity here. I mean, Raman just said he stopped about 120 miles south of Moscow. We don't know why, because he could have kept going and probably right. would have faced just the same amount of resistance, right. which is to say little to none. And then in the midst of this kind of fake deal of the psychopaths, for lack of a better term, he still had opportunity, because if he did indeed have a fifth column at his disposal, he could have tried it again and been successful this time around. So what if you had to kind of get inside his head or try to understand the inner workings of this whole arrangement, what would you say was motivating him?
Well, I mean, the reason why Putin couldn't kill Prigozhin immediately, as Roman suggested, was the fact that at that time, there was too much political capital in the hands of Prigozhin. That included not only electoral capital, because yes, he did poll number two in people's trust after Putin, which had never happened before. And this must have loomed like a scary concept for Putin. But second, he had this fifth column, you call it, but essentially it's a support among the army, part of the army, part of the FSB even, part of the GRU, that preferred somebody motivated, functional, and clear-minded as Prigozhin, in their view, over Putin. So obviously this needed to be neutralized or reduced with time. And one way that I think Putin was expecting this would happen is by just removing Prigozhin from the agenda for a while and showing that everything he did was replaceable with a new, super sophisticated semi-private army that Prigozhin, that Putin started creating. We know of people that were approached to be and were offered to spearhead this army within the army, just showing success without Prigozhin. Now, this didn't happen. It happened actually before all of these replacements had been put in place. So something else must have triggered an earlier than a cold-blooded, cold disposal of Prigozhin, which I expected would happen closer to the end of the year, as I famously said in to the Financial Times. So what could that be? And I think here the reason is connected again to the psychopath's mentality. Now, Prigozhin was forced into a situation to have to believe the deal with Putin.
Yeah,
you could call that naive, but it's in a way how psychopaths think. Psychopaths have zero concept of risk assessment. They have a much higher threshold of risk aversion than any of us. And the second thing that they have is that whenever they're given a choice between a terrible outcome and a bad outcome, they go for the bad outcome and they go full head with it. So Prigozhin must have received a really, really terrible dilemma, a dichotomy on the day that he closed the ascent on Moscow. Something like, I mean, family members could have been kidnapped, and he must have been told, unless you stop and unless you start playing with us, we'll kill them. Something like that. In comparison to which, the deal that he must have received, which is, we'll let bygones be bygones. You stick to Belarus, mm-hmm. and you stick to a couple of places in Africa, but we'll be taking over everything, must have seemed to him like an acceptable outcome, yeah? And he fully designated his own mindset to that outcome because he's a psychopath, and it didn't work out because Putin is a big psychopath, right? So...
But has Putin effectively neutralized this pro-Prigozhin, pro-Wagner element within his own government? I mean, that's the big question.
I'll give a very short answer, and I'm interested in Roma's. I was expecting to see what the Wagnerites would do in the wake of their leader and their kind of guru being taken out, and whether they would immediately take on the Kremlin again. What Putin did right here is, from his point of view, he decapitated the whole of Wagner. So everybody who could have taken the army onto the Kremlin to avenge for the death of Prigozhin was gone. Mm-hmm. Those two guys were in the plane. So I think that there is a strong potential for the Wagnerites, the ex-Wagnerites, to be instrumentalized into a new coup mm-hmm. by a group of generals in a few months, not now. Actually, I asked this question to one of our sources in Wagner. Will there be an immediate reaction, an immediate attack on the traitors, as they call Putin now, right? And he said, very matter of fact, as usual, said, no, not now. Everybody who would want to do that would need to know that they should only start when they can get into the Kremlin and get rid of Putin. Mm. So they won't do it until they have the plan in action. I said, but will there be another attempt? They said, absolutely. So I think that's what my point of view would be, that in a few months we'll see somebody instrumentalizing these Wagnerites, to put them very bluntly, and do another attempt. What do you think, Roman?
Yeah, well, but I think that if we speak about this mutiny or coup that happened in June, we also need to provide our audience some context about like atmosphere in which it happened, because many people thought that this was just not motivated military against very motivated Wagner group, while we and me personally, I also thought that these people who are going to Moscow, they feel some anger and they're really desperate about taking power. But when we spoke with these people, it looked like they weren't absolutely not inspired with this idea, and I would say this was the laziest coup in the world's history, when no one wants to participate on any side. So absolutely no general wanted to when Kremlin tried to bring their troops, their generals immediately because of the coup, all of them pretended to be on vacation, on to be drunk, or just didn't respond to phone calls and stayed at home. And the people from Wagner's group also said that, like, oh, they told us to go to Moscow. We will not do anything before we get the written order or something like this. And many people, by the way, really also didn't participate. So it was 10,000, but Prigozhin said that he had 40,000 of troops. So these people didn't like very much the idea to fight against some other Russian people who will defend Moscow. So it's not like when during the civil war in 100 days ago, when Red Army, they had this communist party, they had their own ideology. Their view of their future. I think it's a little bit different thing. It's that there are some psychopaths with their ambitions, and most of other people don't want either to participate on a side of the attacking one, neither to defend the ruling one, because they hate this current situation And it's more like, well, if Prigozhin wins, maybe something will change, and any change will be for good now, because we are in a very, very deep as now with this old war, and we don't see any other possible escape. So I think this was an atmosphere, and we need to take it into consideration, because that means that it's not like people with different ideologies fighting for power. It's just the situation when the it's a kind of failed state, and there are lots of different dozens actually of different militarized forces in the country that don't trust anyone, and they don't trust each other within their own intelligence, so they can't organize anything on their own, and they just don't want to participate in any other fight. So this is how it looks. So that's, I agree with Christo that we possibly will see some other coup, because everybody saw that how easy it can be done, but it's very difficult to organize it, because when people don't trust each other at all, it's difficult to organize anything within this structure.
But so we're sort of juggling two contradictory ideas here at the same time. One, and there's evidence to support this. The Ukrainians, for instance, have been canvassing opinion of Wagner fighters from going back to almost the beginning of the war. And they noticed that this is a very cult-like atmosphere. Extreme adulation, worship of Prigozhin, they called him Batya. Utter disdain for contract or mobilized soldiers working at MOD. What are you fighting for? There's no glory. There's no money. At least if we get killed and, you know, the meat grinder of Bakhmut, our families will live high on the hog for the rest of their lives. What are you guys doing? You're idiots. You should join with us. And yet, what you just described was a kind of universal lassitude throughout. Like on the one hand, the Wagner putschists weren't keen to march on Moscow, didn't really know what they were doing. They kind of, you know, sort of carried away, I guess, by the momentum of the moment, but didn't have the ideological zealotry that you would need to really press forward with a coup, that at least one that's successful. And then, as we discussed on the other side, you know, sorry, I was out partying late last night. I can't stop this internal security threat to Fortress Russia, you know, see you next week kind of shit. So where does that leave the Russian regime? Where does it leave the cadres that it relies on, not only to prosecute this war in Ukraine, but also to safeguard its own security? I mean, Putin's life, which we know he is deeply paranoid about losing. It's why he has food testers. It's why he takes fecal samples of people visiting. It's why he travels on an armored train. Where does that leave the state of his dictatorship? I mean, it seems like he's actually quite vulnerable. And yet, you know, I'm reading this week all innumerable Western articles saying he has never been stronger. His grip on power is uncontested. This shows that he's, you know, this master godfather figure who liquidates all his enemies. And it doesn't seem that way to me from what we're discussing.
No, I mean, I think if the question is, does Putin feel weaker or stronger now than 2 months ago? To me, the answer is definitely weaker. Mm. There are so many things that changed. One is that the public had never seen anybody oppose Putin, and now they saw somebody close to Putin oppose Putin. And that alone talks about, shows the feasibility of this. And it's very important in dictatorships and in mafia structures to know that people would only support with all of their heart and mind the boss, the mafia boss, if they're sure that the mafia boss will be there forever. Mm-hmm. Because otherwise, any adulation, any support for the boss might be used against them. So, give you an example. If Putin now gives the order for somebody to do something very illegal, like go and kill Navalny in jail, right? Yeah. As an example. I think, given the latest 2 months, this becomes less likely to be taken as an order, because, well, I don't know what's going to happen. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I know that Wagnerites and Surovikin, who's a general that everybody said was a great guy, now they tried to go after Putin. How do I know who will do this next week? So that's why I think the acceptance of the absolute rule of Putin is much lower now than 2 months ago, even though obviously he had to do this ruthless show of force to at least minimize that risk, or to scare at least some of them. But that just shows to the rest of the people that he's not all powerful.
Mm. And especially if he starts to lose the war in Ukraine even more so than he has already. For instance, if this counteroffensive in the south is successful and the direct line of communication to Crimea is cut off, he looks even weaker because the one goal that has set all of these things in motion is now, you know, that much more distant. Let me ask you, let's turn the conversation to, we know that fundamentally Putin gave the order and he is the architect of Prigozhin's demise. But let's talk about who done it. So today there was an article in the British media suggesting that our old friend Avryanov, the commander of Unit 29155, this is a GRU special task unit that's set up to do sabotage operations, terrorist attacks, really, and murder, responsible for poisoning the Skripals in Salisbury, blowing up Czech and Bulgarian ammunition depots and warehouses, et cetera, over the last, 10 years now. Christo, you probably know about, well, both of you know Avryanov's biography better than anybody on the planet. What is the likelihood that he's responsible for this? And what does that say about what you just were describing, which is, you know, taking risks on behalf of the weakened, if not debilitated, czar?
Right. I mean, anybody who would take those risks would do it in return for something. Mm. So it'd have to be a really sweet deal.
Yeah.
And Avryanov is the kind of guy who would look forward to and take a sweet deal. This is a very corrupt, deeply corrupt person. You would imagine that people in the GRU are very ideological, unlike the FSB, because they don't have a lot of vertical elevator opportunities, right? But not people in the special ops. But these are people who lived the life for 15 years. They were traveling abroad under fake identities, going to an operation where they were supposed to blow up something or kill something. But on the way, they had a credit card with unlimited credit issued by the GRU in the name of a fake identity. And they were buying thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars worth of presents for their lovers, for their underage lovers. And then they would say, well, I needed to do that in order to show that I'm a real person, right?
Right.
So this is the lifestyle. Now, imagine somebody like this, Avryanov, and I am referring to a lot of young girlfriends that he was running, being confronted with an offer he can't refuse by Putin, to use another analogy, another term from the Godfather. This would be something like, you'll get Africa and you'll get 10% of the spoils. You'll get 10% of the diamond. I mean, Prigozhin was getting 30%. You'll get 10%, but for you and your girlfriends, that's a big deal. So it would be a deal like that. Now, would he be the one he would go to? That's the most logical answer. First of all, because surprisingly, he was given visibly or openly the role of replacing Wagner in Africa. Mm-hmm. He showed up and was presented to all these African dictators in St. Petersburg as the guy in charge of security. Now, read between the lines. That means he's your new,
new boss.
Prigozhin, right? And second, he has the skill set. He has the skill set to make things explode in midair. That's literally his people. I mean, that's what he's done internationally. That's what he's done. Many people don't know that the GRU, this unit, also did it in Russia. They did it in particular places. They did it in the Caucasus. They did it in Chechnya. They were constantly traveling under fake identities between Moscow and Mineralne Vody in that's Dagestan, right? Or where it is? Well, somewhere in the region.
Oh, I don't remember myself.
Yes, and to Chechnya. So they were doing already assassinations and explosions within Russia. And this was so logical for him to be tasked with because his goal was replace Prigozhin in Africa. Well, that's one of the steps.
And I mean, it's interesting because the origin of the GRU or what they were tasked with doing in the Soviet period was external, not preparing basically for war with the West, you know, ferreting away weapons and ammunition caches in the English countryside, let's say, for when World War III were to break out. And yet, 2 years before the full-scale invasion, I was in Kyiv and I was interviewing Valery Kondratyuk, who was then the head of Ukraine's military intelligence service, GUR. And he said, you know, we have assessed that 29155 is also conducting Mokrodielo operations inside Russian Federation territory. And more to the point, bypassing the typical chain of command, which is the chief of the general staff, and then to the Ministry of Defense, and then to the Kremlin, they answer directly to Putin and basically provide him with a menu of options. Who would you like to kill today? Or what can we do for you, you know, this week kind of thing? And this is kind of an extraordinary development for the service, that they have this bespoke unit that's not FSB or one of the legacy KGB services units, of the KGB, but it's the GRU that's responsible.
But I think, by the way, that Averyanov would eagerly kill Prigozhin even for free without any Africa deals, because that first day of the coup was absolutely humiliating for GRU and military, because when you see this video when Prigozhin sits with General Alexeyev, deputy chief of GRU, and General Yevkurov, deputy minister of defense, and he's just like lecturing them as kids and shouting, "Give me Shoigu," and they are like unarmed and they're looking more like prisoners than leaders of Russian army. This was absolutely a humiliation, and just put yourself in the shoes of, I don't know, a Russian colonel who reports to these generals and who sees that, like, this is literally like no one who is Prigozhin, he has no legal or legitimate status, who is speaking with his generals like this. So I think if what you previously asked, so if Putin is stronger or weaker than he used to be, so I think that maybe he's weaker than before the coup, but he's stronger than before assassination. Because before, like a week ago, when Prigozhin was still alive, Putin, in eyes of all the military and eyes of all the people who were like loyal to Putin's strategy, he was seen absolutely weak as a person who can't respond on such a big insult. So now he restored maybe not 100%, but some share of his reputation, at least in these circles. But on the other hand, he lost some legitimacy and support from those circles who supported Prigozhin as a person, as a truth speaker, as a person who goes against all this bureaucracy, who is like the father of soldiers. So he has, and Christo mentioned that he was second in opinion polls, he was second as most trusted, or you, Michael, mentioned, he was second most trusted people 2 months ago. It's only, of course, we can't know this for sure, because only 5% answer to pollsters. So 95% never speak with them. So it's only among those people who feel safe enough to speak with sociologists. But anyway, that does matter. Even if we speak only about the loyal people, to be the second most trusted is very important. And when you kill this person and you show that you are not negotiating with this kind of people, you still lose some legitimacy in this patriotic, so-called patriotic share of population. So that makes Putin weaker too.
Talking about perception of weakness, I'd like to quote some yet unpublished data from polling that was done yesterday by the Open Minds Institute. So it's not a Russian-based entity, but one headquartered, I think, in the US and in Ukraine, about how people feel after the assassination. And three numbers I'll quote is that 50%, approximately half of people in Russia, believe Putin was behind the assassination. 25% of the people believe that there will be a repeat coup attempt in the next few months. And about 65% believe that Russia is in a much less stable situation today than it was 2 months ago. So, Roman, this may have been 75% before the assassination, but it's still the majority of the people think Russia is less stable than it was before the coup.
But it is still, we need to always to mention that this is only those several percent who agree to speak with the pollsters, meaning that if 95% refuse to speak with the pollsters, it may be because they think their view on the world is not the most, the one they want to share with the people who know where they live or they know their phone numbers, right? So that means, but I agree with you that this we can rely on this post when we try to analyze the viewpoint of the loyal people, because they are those people who speak with sociologists, and even they are absolutely sure that Putin did it, so they don't trust propaganda on this issue, they think that made him stronger, which I agree in their perception and in perception of Russian military. Of course, that was a demonstration of strength, definitely.
But the other interesting fact from this poll, if a quarter of the population thinks that a second coup is inevitable, you know, determinism like this can be its own accomplice to events.
No.
That suggests that when and if it happens, at least 25% of the population is going to shrug and say, well, you know, we knew this was coming and what are we going to do? So in other words, Putin does not seem to have, you know, one of the abiding, maybe this is a myth in terms of the Western understanding of Russia for the last 30 some odd years, and God knows there have been plenty of those myths, was that Putin had restored the credibility and the strength of the Russian nation. He was deeply popular. Everybody liked him, supported him. There was no alternative to his rule. And now all of a sudden we've seen more customary Russian means of violent overthrow and murder. And yet, again, we come back to this core issue of mass popular indifference to who actually is in the cockpit, right? If it's Putin, who cares? If it's Pashchev, who cares? If it's Prigozhin, who cares? You know, maybe one of them will improve our lot, even in a minuscule fashion. Maybe one of them will advance our interests in the war, such as we have interests in the war, which I'm not even convinced that a lot of Russians do at this point. So what are we really saying here? That is this the beginning of the end of Putin's regime? And it's just a question of maybe he's deferred or he's slowed down the clock, but he hasn't stopped it. Or is there still a way for him to, I don't know, defy expectation again and liquidate all of his enemies, both those that are known to us now and those that we have yet to understand are indeed enemies?
Well, I mean, I think Putin's formula at the moment depends only on the continued indifference of the large part of the population. Because only in that scenario, we're not going to see the catalyzing of three distinct constituencies that are as antagonistic as any pre-civil war situation in any country. You're seeing the liberals who hate what's happening, and so far they're either leaving the country or silently objecting. You have the pro-Putin aficionados who are usually of an age that makes them very kind of non-fight worthy.
Mm-hmm.
But then you have a new thing that didn't exist before, which is a very weaponized, very motivated and angry minority that preferred Prigozhin because he's more efficient and he's more cruel than Putin. And those people are unsatisfied, but they will continue to be somewhat passive for now. And I think that the passivity is a function also of how comfortable their life still is. I mean, comfortable in very relative terms, comfortable for Russians who are used to much worse than most of the rest of the world. So I think the economic situation in the next few months is going to be a clear determinant of whether or not this pre-civil war situation we have in Russia becomes active, or will it remain latent? So, Roman, you're a political scientist, PhD. What would you say about that?
Well, yeah, I think that we shall notice elephant is in the room, which is that Putin is 70 years old man, and everybody understands that, well, he's the only one in Russia who really wants this war and that intense conflict with the West, because no one in... I'm not speaking about like democratic position. I'm speaking about Russian oligarchs or even generals from different intelligence and military. No one really needs this conflict with the West. So it looks like all the country sits and waits when Putin will die, either because someone kills him or because he's old. And this by itself makes him weak anyway, because it's not like in China when you have a political system with a certain ideology, with a very complicated mechanism of changing of power, where you know that it will overlive any leader, though now Xi Jinping is a little bit more charismatic than usually other Chinese leaders, and a little bit more maybe unilateral in his decisions. But still, it's a system that is, and you see that these institutions will overlive the people who represent them. But in Russia, it's not the case now, because everybody understands that as soon as the second Putin dies, everything will change, because no one wants status quo that exists now. So if everybody understands that the situation will change anyway, the elites will change anyway, and the situation, like relations with the West and everything, will change. So why wait then? Why we would trust these people now if it's not for long? So every year makes Putin weaker and weaker, and he feels that. And I think this is one of the reasons why he becomes more and more like a totalitarian dictator, because he needs more and more threats and strength to suppress this growing opposition.
So you don't believe one of the lines that has been fed to American Russia watchers for ages, both from the intel level and the analytic community, is that, well, if you think Putin's bad, wait till you see who's going to take over, who's waiting in the wings. I mean, not Zhirinovsky himself, but somebody more of that mentality, you know, ultra-nationalistic, almost apocalyptic in his views of the West. You know, Patrushev is always whispered about as somebody who makes Putin look rather kittenish by comparison. But Roman, what you're saying is you don't believe this to be the case. You think that everybody is going to say, okay, enough is enough. We've seen how this man has single-handedly driven the country back 30 plus years. We got to get rid of him, or we have to.
Yeah, yeah, because we don't see any grassroots support for the fascist part of this elite. I mean, when Girkin was arrested, there were like a dozen of people near the court. When Prigozhin is now killed, yeah, there are some people who brought some flowers in Moscow and St. Petersburg, most people who were in Wagner's group, but that doesn't sound like he has real millions of the people who share views with him. I think he was popular not because he was this kind of brutal thug, but because he just told the things that many people agreed with, now some people don't remember it. But he said that the war in Ukraine was actually a mistake, and it was a very bad idea, and that we did it very wrong, and that we were drugged in it. We didn't so it was. And he said this in the moment when he had the highest public support, and when he started his coup, he immediately lost a very big part of the support, because these people who were loyal to Putin didn't want to choose between him and Putin. They just loved him because he was kind of alleged person who still told some truth.
Mm. Well, let's talk about what the most likely culprit appointed by the Kremlin will be for the assassination. Mm. What do you think, Roman? Who will be the guilty one? Who will be the lightning rod?
Well, I think it doesn't matter. Was it a missile or bomb? Or they would say that it is a Ukrainian bomb, because they had nothing else to say, which still will sound stupid, because why would Ukrainians need Prigozhin now when he's out of any like military control? But again, they have nothing else to say.
On the contrary, I think the Ukrainians at a certain point saw Prigozhin as advancing their interests, because, you know, he was the one attacking MOD. He was the one basically calling out all of the lies and propaganda of this war. And you notice, like, Budanov, the only military faction that he ranks with any, you know, degree of respect or credibility was Wagner. And Wagner is now, according to the Pentagon as of today, completely a non-factor on the battlefield in Ukraine.
Yes, so, this is actually the biggest victory of Ukraine in last months. But I think that we shouldn't overestimate the importance of public opinion now in Russia. So, yeah, I think like everybody would understand that this is Putin, and they all understand that this was just a criminal thing to do. But Putin doesn't really care what the majority of Russians think about this. Or it's like maybe several years ago he would care, but now in this kind of situation, you know, like as if there was something legitimate about anything of that. The existence of Prigozhin was absolutely illegal and illegitimate thing because it is a criminal offense to have private military cooperation in Russia. You would be imprisoned in 20 years if you would like abide by the Russian laws for having a private military cooperation. And still this person met with Vladimir Putin after the coup, negotiating what will be their terms of their peaceful treaty. Is there anything legal about this? It's just how criminals decide everything about what they do in mafia, and it has nothing to do with the law. So that's why would they bother to think a lot about how they killed them? It's already a new epoch in Russia, a new era, and no one now cares about what Russian housewives would think about that.
I still would give a small placeholder for the possibility that they assign Kadyrov's people as the guilty ones. They've done it before, seems to be a favorite. Kadyrov seems to like it because he gets his own boost of ego and popularity among the craziest in Chechnya. So
they're the convenient bogeyman. I mean, when Nemtsov was murdered, everyone says, oh, it must have been Kadyrovites because, you know, he was attacking, Kadyrov himself was attacking Nemtsov just days earlier and, you know, all this stuff. And
But not only that, we've investigated with Roman at least 13 assassinations conducted by the FSB's external unit, the Vimpel guys, usually of Chechen sort of rebels or people who fought against Russia abroad. And in almost every case, they tried to set it up as if Kadyrov did it.
Yeah.
But they don't trust Kadyrov, so they do it themselves. So this could be just one of those.
But that was a different situation because that was mostly Chechen people abroad. So it was very convenient to say, well, this is something between the Chechens.
Yeah.
And also when it was murder of Nemtsov, where also, as we know, FSB actually controlled the situation, but Chechens were ones who pulled the trigger. There also it was a different situation because they needed to show that there was someone with motivation to do this, but not the government. But here, no one would believe that Kadyrov has any interest in involving in that. They had some conflict, yes, but it will make Putin weaker if everybody would say that this is Kadyrov, because everyone needs to think that this was Putin taking a revenge. So right. it would be, I think, humiliating for Vladimir Putin if everybody would think that it was not him, but some other guy from... And
then you suffer from an embarrassment of rogue actors with their own kind of sovereign missions, you
right.
know? Prigozhin does a coup, so Kadyrov takes out the coup leader, you know?
It would create even more
exactly.
Centrifugal centers of power. So absolutely, I agree. But still, doesn't mean that they're smart. So let's see what they do. Mm-hmm. But I agree, Ukrainians are the most likely appointed culprit.
Which also boosts their capacity for deep strike and you know, penetrative operations. I mean, if
that's also embarrassing, right? That's also embarrassing.
If for Russia, yes, absolutely.
Do that, why? Yeah.
I mean, the Ukrainians probably quietly will lean into that conspiracy theory.
Yes, sure. Whatever you say.
Anyway, look.
Next will be a different plane.
Exactly. Well, you know, you become a kind of hostage to your own reputation. Yeah. I mean, Dugina and other attempts or successful operations that Gur has carried out. Why not Prigozhin as well? Well, anyway, look, fascinating discussion, as I knew it would be. And we hope that this will be the first of many such discussions that we have, not just about what's happening in the news cycle that we are not responsible for, but also investigations that
or aren't we?
investigations that we publish and are working on. And at the moment, there are, what, 50 plus big ones coming down the pipeline? And, you know, my job and the role of an English language version of The Insider is to kind of mainline it directly to non-Russian speaking audiences. So we hope you'll tune in again next time. And thanks for watching and listening.
Thanks. Thank you.